I went to a doctor's office, and it's not Dr. Dickhead that I was telling you about. This is a different doctor. He's a doctor because he got a business card and he put DR period on it. His office was such a piece of shit that you could hear the conversation going on between the doctor and the patient ahead of you, which is never supposed to happen. So as I'm waiting for my turn to go in, I'm waiting and I hear the doctor go, "Oh, what is your medical need for marijuana?" And the guy in there goes, "Oh, I have a bone disease." And I was like, "Oh shit, I don't have a bone disease." Like, I thought you'd just be like, "Weed's awesome." And he'd be like, "Yeah, I fucking know, man." Like, so I start to panic internally, like, what am I gonna say? And in my mind, I just go to the worst shit. Like, in my mind, I'm like, "Just say you have AIDS. Like, just tell him you have AIDS." And he'll be like, "When you find out?" I'd be like, "I just found out like 5 minutes ago." "You don't seem that bummed out." "Well, I'm just happy to be here. So let's wrap this shit up, man." For some reason, I picture him asking me to prove it, which they would never be like, "Prove it." And then you're like, "Oh, I left my AIDS card at home. I don't have it on me." Then I go, "That's way too dramatic. Just dial it back." I'm like, "Ah, I'll just say I have cancer. That's much more believable." And then I start thinking of all my family members that have died of cancer. And I'm like, "Man, if I say I have cancer just to get weed, I am getting cancer next fucking week." By the time I have that thought, I'm sitting in front of the doctor. He's like, I go, "What?" He goes, "What is your medical need for marijuana?" And the best I can come up with on the spot is, "My eyes hurt." And he goes, "You have vision problems?" And I go, "Oh yeah." And he goes, "You don't wear glasses?" And I go, "Can't, hurts. Everything hurts, ow, ow. He writes me a prescription. I go to leave. As I leave, I see the guy who's going in next. And I don't know why I think it's gonna be funny to listen, because I think he's not gonna get it. And I'll tell you why. I completely judge the guy, because the guy's your typical LA cholo Mexican gangbanger, okay? It's a very specific look. You've seen movies, you know what the fuck I'm talking about. Khaki Dickies with an oversized white t-shirt, Chuck Taylors, an LA hat, and also an LA tat in like this general area here. So it's like, "Oh, if I lose my hat, I still have my favorite team right fucking here." So I listen at the door, I'm like, "Ha." And I hear the doctor go, "What is your medical need for marijuana?" And the guy goes, "I just really like the way that weed makes me feel." And then the doctor wrote him a prescription for that. Yeah, you don't have to lie. You can just be like, "Weed's awesome." And he's like, "Yeah, I fucking know. I feel sorry for all the people with diseases that keep coming in here, man. The last dude's eyes didn't even work. It was sad. You're lucky you have your health essay." Orale.
The election of 2012 changed the course of American history. 3 states legalized gay marriage. 2 states legalized marijuana. Yeah. So when the Bible says if a man lays with another man, he should be stoned. I think some people miss the fucking point. I think it's fucked up that weed is legal and Twinkies went out of business. It's like the Lord giveth and taketh away. Colorado became the first place in the world to legalize marijuana. I think they should change their state flag to a Dorito bag. They actually have vacations you can take just to get high. That's great for adults, but that's fucked up for kids. How come we can't go skiing? Because your daddy just bought an ounce. And who the fuck are you anyway? I don't know why they call it recreational marijuana. What the fuck is so recreational about stopping at a stop sign waiting for it to turn green? I'm about to run this motherfucker, everybody. Ooh, my throat hurt. Do your throat hurt? My throat. You ever been so high you swerve to avoid a tree? And then realize it's that air freshener hanging from your rearview mirror. Oh my God, I ran into the woods. I smell pine. Have you ever been so high you look at yourself in the mirror and tell yourself you high? Like, you are high. And you answer yourself back, I know. I am high. There have been some benefits associated with marijuana that nobody anticipated. For instance, all the states who have legalized marijuana experienced a 25% reduction in suicide rates. Because it's hard to kill yourself when you don't remember where you put the fucking rope. Like, what the fuck did I come in a garage for? Oh, well, I'm hungry in a motherfucker. Ooh, Captain Crunch and pickles. What is this rope doing here? I must be a cowboy.
People always ask me, how do I travel with weed? How do I get everywhere with weed? And it's pretty simple, actually. The answer is edibles, you know? When it comes to actual flowers, I count on the kindness of strangers everywhere I go because pot smokers are the coolest and the nicest and, you know, they hook me up. Yeah. I love it. But edibles when flying, you know, especially domestically. Internationally, I wouldn't really fuck with anything because you just never know. But domestically, TSA doesn't give a shit about your, you know, cookies, breath strips, pills, vapor pens. You know, vapor pens all look like e-cigs, you know? Looks like we're all just trying to take back our freedom, Stephen Dorff style.
I fly with all that shit all the time. Blackout X pens, I fly with them all the time, and they never say a word to me about any of it. And if they did, like, how's that even gonna go down? Like, is TSA really gonna pull a brownie out of somebody's bag and be like, what's this? And you'd have to be like, that's a brownie. And they'd be like, what's in this brownie? And you'd be like, you know, brownie fixins. Like all the shit you throw into a bowl to turn it into a brownie. Maybe with a little something extra special. Then if they came right out and asked, are there drugs in this brownie? This is what I would say to them. I'd be like, I tell you what, why don't you take a bite and get back to me in 45 minutes to an hour when your life has improved tremendously and you're so happy that you no longer work for the TSA. Give me a buzz. I'll be high on a plane getting to the next town where more people will get me high. Yeah, it's crazy. You can't have liquids when you're going through security at the airport. No liquids, but you can have any food at all. Like, so does that mean, like, kind of liquidy foods are okay? I think so. I think you could take a pan of lasagna through airport security. I think you just throw it in your bag and they'd just be like, what's with this pan of lasagna? And you could just be like, I hate Mondays. You know? Just leave it at that. I've been caught about 4 times in my history of smoking weed in hotel rooms. I've been fined or yelled at or thrown out of the hotel a total of about 4 times, which I think is an amazing batting average for like thousands of hotel stays. You know, I'm serious about it, you know? I put a wet towel in the crack of the door leading into the hallway so that smell that's so great doesn't offend any a-holes walking by. Like, that first time I got caught, I didn't even know what was happening. There was an extra charge of $200 on my credit card bill, and I got all fired up like, oh, they charged me for an extra night, that damn hotel. I'm gonna call them up and give them the what for. And I called them up, and the guy comes on, and I'm like, hey, man, what's this extra $200 charge on my bill? And he says, that's because you smoked in your room. Oh, no. Now I had to think fast. I had to say just the right thing. And I think I did. Because I said, no, I didn't.
but he came back hard. Because he was like, the housekeeper smelt it. To which I had to say, maybe she dealt it.
So now I'm back buying comedy clubs, hanging out with strangers, smoking whatever random shit they hand me. Super safe, right? I almost find it insulting that I've never woken up in a stranger's van going, what the fuck? No one wants to rape me, is that what you're telling me? Not one person in all of North America wants to rape me. I did that joke in Portland, and as soon as I said not one person wants to rape me, a bunch of people in the audience went, aww. That's such a fucking Portland response. A bunch of sweet hippies up there. They're like, oh, come on, you guys, as Oregonians, we should step up and show this guy some Portland spirit and take this fat bear behind a building and make that shit happen. 503 in the hizzy. Traveling with weed sucks. I've spoken about that before. I don't travel with weed because I would get super paranoid. I mean, I talk about what a freak I am. Oh, my God, when I'm full of weed, high as fuck, and I'm going through TSA, and I'm just sweating, herb, just, ugh. And I've got a sack under my sack. And that tank nugget. Oh, my God, somebody really likes puns. I love that. You with the crazy laugh, you're going to enjoy. I've hidden a couple more puns in my act, and by hidden, I mean, I become Yosemite Sam when I make a pun. I fucking love wordplay so much, I want to shoot fucking holes in the ceiling. Like, fun with words. So they'll be easy to find. Even the dum-dums will figure out when I made a pun. I got busted. Oh, I almost got busted when I wasn't even carrying. I flew into Calgary. But here's the story, I was super, super high. Oh my God, and I was sweating so much weed, and I got high with a bunch of strangers in North Carolina. And then I get on a plane, and I fly into Calgary, Canada, fucking high out of my skull. Yeah, it's a place. And I'm super, super high, and I gotta go through customs. And I make it through the first level of customs. Second level of customs, it's the two customs officers and the dog. Yeah, here's two things about me. I love animals, and I'm fucking stupid. Because my natural reaction to seeing that drug dog was to go, hey, pretty girl, how are we doing today? The dog's like, you fucking idiot. You just made my job super, super easy, you fucking giant stoner. And the dog does this, walks up, and sits at my feet, right? Which is how they let their trainers know. They're like, you're high, or you have weed, or you're a Muslim. And, yeah, I didn't know about the politically incorrect doggy training going at the Calgary airport. I just thought it was the most fucking adorable thing I'd seen all week. I'm like, who's making friends today? We are! Who likes ear rubs? Everybody. That's right, all the doggies in Doggyland love to have their ears rubbed because it makes their foot go crazy. And the dog's like, dude, seriously, shut the fuck up. You are blowing it super, super hard, dude. And the dog was right. Apparently, I was fucking blowing it. Because the two dudes take me away from my new friend. And I'm like, where are we going? She's pretty. They bring me into another room that none of you want to go into at the Calgary airport. Because in that room, in my experience, is the meanest lady I've ever met in my life. Yeah, mean lady at the Calgary airport was all fucking business. She goes through my bags, makes me take off my clothes. Not the first time I've been nude in front of a mean lady. It's kind of a recurring theme. A lot of disappointment when this dude nudes up. And the two dudes start to leave me, and that's when I panic. I'm like, what's going on, fellas? Why am I in here in the first place? And the guy goes, well, sir, the dog indicated you. And at the time, I was still fucking high, so I'm like, well, all right. That makes sense, I guess. But in retrospect, I'm pretty fucking sure I indicated myself. Because you know who tries to hug drug dogs? People on drugs! My buddy in L.A. is a pot dealer. He's been my dealer for a long time and a good friend of mine. And he's super excited about weed being legal everywhere. He's like, it's going to be awesome, dude, when it's legal everywhere. And I'm like, not for you. Because think about it. You'll never use a dealer again when you don't fucking have to. When you can go to Costco and buy in bulk. Right? You're not going to sit on some dude's shitty couch in his gross apartment and hear him talk about his fucking obsidian collection ever again. Because if you've ever bought weed from a dude, and I have, you know you got to hang out in your dealer's house and hear about his boring-ass hobby he just picked up. Hey, brother, just found out I'm 172nd Cherokee, so I started collecting arrowheads. Wow, brother, I just found out I'm 3/4. I fucking hate you. Let me go. Tell your girlfriend she doesn't have to hide in your bedroom when I come over. I'm not buying guns, you fucking weirdos. Just weed.
A lot of America's still living this big lie, this big song and dance that comes with smoking marijuana. We've been doing it for years. One of the latest examples to me would be the very word dispensary. Do you remember that word even 5 years ago? What does that mean? That sounds like a FEMA tent set outside of a disaster area. Everybody head to the dispensary for rations. Right? It doesn't say... But the reason they call it dispensary, folks, is for that medical lie. The one, you know, a lot of people use it that way, but a lot of people, you know, we're just trying to get our buzz on. But they call it dispensary because they want to make it sound like the word pharmacy. It sounds medicinal. It sounds legitimate. But the first dispensary that opened up in my neighborhood was called Star Buds. Does that sound like a legit pharmacy to you? Would you go to a pharmacy called Sir Lance Zoloft's? The Prozac Shack. Would you go to that pharmacy with the fun pun name? Lexapropolis. I'm gonna go get the baby's medicine at Xanax Do. You wouldn't do that, would you? How many pharmacies do you have to ask the pharmacist, is this medicine good stuff? Is this allergy medicine good stuff? Oh yeah, that Claritin strain's pretty good. But you should check out this birth control I just got in. Your lady won't be pregnant for years on this shit, man.
I hope whoever the next president is, they legalize weed. I don't understand why weed is still illegal. It's the most harmless vice on the planet. And I'm a weed advocate. I talk about weed so much on Facebook and Twitter. I get people to come up to me after my shows and hand me nickel bags, blunts, joints. I had a white boy one time give me some edible weed. I wish somebody would have told me that edible weed is 50 times more potent than the shit you smoke. And when white boys give you weed, they come with warning labels. You gotta listen to shit they say. I had a white dude give me 5 miniature Reese's Pieces-sized cups of edible weed. I was like, dog, is this shit even strong? This white boy looked me dead in my face and was like, dude, trust me. You do that, you're gonna see tomorrow today. God damn. I ate all 5 of them motherfuckers. I was driving home. I was like, man, this ain't shit. Cut to, I'm in my house, butt naked. Making carpet angels, nigga. My nuts had 8 hours of rug burn. That shit was serious. I like to smoke weed and watch Maury Povich. That's how I start my morning, an egg McMuffin, a blunt, and Maury Povich. I love them Who the Baby Daddy shows, man. That is black ignorance at its finest. Like, I don't understand how come when a nigga find out he ain't the father, he got to pop lock and break dance. Terrell Jackson, you are not the father. Oh, told you, bitch. I like when the girl find out he ain't the father and she take that long run down the hall and just fall flat to the floor. Like, no disrespect to my big girls, but if you are 250 pounds and you run at top speed and fall suddenly to the floor, you look like a baby elephant being shot in the wild. Psh. toes and fat ankle meat all in the air. Look at all the big bitches. Fat chick leg look like gyro meat with a heel at the bottom of it. Oh, fuck y'all, that is funnier than that. Next time you see Yido meat on a spinning spool, put a heel at the bottom of that. It's a fat chick leg, nigga. Look at all the skinny girls comforting their fat friends, girl. He ain't talking about you. Fuck him, he ain't talking about you. And I know some of you big girls gonna be mad at me and talk about me in the car on the ride home. Why you laughing what the nigga said? It's all good, baby, baby. Skinny girls love that joke. Y'all go to work the next day and fuck with your fat coworker in their cubicle. Why you keep making that noise? I just got something stuck in my throat, girl. Baby, baby.
I ordered an hourglass, and man, it came, and I was so excited. I didn't know what I needed it for, but I was like, I need one. Well, the problem was that I ordered a wristwatch, and an hourglass came. I'm like, ah, oh, damn it, you know? Don't order stuff online high, you know? But I used it. It was great. I would use it to time everything. I would time my showers. I just go for it, you know? And I would check in with it, just... I'm like, I still got some sand, you know what I mean? I would time my number twos, that was fun, you know? Just go for it, like, all right. I learned something. I learned that your legs fall asleep about the hour mark, so. That was fun, you know? But I kept using it, and I felt like something was off. I did not know what it was, you know? And so I used my phone, and I timed it, because, hell, I got all day, you know? So I timed it and I stopped at 47 minutes. I'm like, oh, that can't be right. So let's try it again, you know? Timed it, stopped it, 47 minutes. I'm like, damn, now what? So I called customer service. And I said, excuse me, I'm having a hard time with my hourglass. It seems to be defective. And she's like, well, how can I help you? I said, well, I just need you to send me 13 minutes worth of sand. Hello? She's like, I'm here. I'm like, all right, cool. She's like, that seems very odd to me. I'm like, yeah, you're telling me, you know? She's like, well, how would I even do that? I'm like, look, just send me 13 minutes worth of sand. I'm like, grab an hourglass, turn it over, wait 13 minutes, put your finger there. Put that in the baggie and send it to me. She's like, this is the craziest call I've ever had. She's like, how much does 13 minutes worth of sand even weigh? I said, great question. Let me look it up. So I looked it up on Google conversion and I learned something. I found out that you can't convert volume to time. Even Google was like, what the fuck did you mean? So I told her, I said, I can't convert volume to time. She's like, you know what? I'm gonna put you on hold. I'm gonna talk to my manager. I said, great, thank you, appreciate it. So I'm on hold for an hour. I'm just waiting, listening to classical music, some Chopin, who knows, right? She comes back. She's like, you know what? I have some answers for you. I said, I'm all ears. All right. She's like, well, it turns out that sometimes the manufacturers of hourglasses change the source from which the sand comes from. So there's some discrepancies in the sand. Therefore, you know, sometimes you get a different count on the hour. And I said, well, I don't know what you just said, you know? I said, I was on hold for an hour for that. She's like, are you sure it wasn't 47 minutes? I'm like, all right. I'm like, game on, lady.
People think I'm high all the time because I talk kind of slow and I look like a high school jazz teacher. Hey, everybody, put your oboes down for a second. I want to tell you about that time I smoked Moroccan hash with Gil Scott Heron. Scabba-da-bee-bop-boop-bop-ba-doop. It fits. At least three of you were like, Mr. Thibodeau? I'll do shows, and after shows, people will bring me pot as though they are bringing Gatorade to a marathon runner. He's like, out of my way, he needs this to finish!
I was doing some shows. I was doing a weekend of shows in San Francisco. And after, one person's heard of it, sure. It's a small city. You guys should check it out sometime. I was doing a weekend of shows in San Francisco. And after one of the shows, this guy came up to me and he brought me a Ziploc freezer bag, gallon size, filled to the brim with weed. Now that is a very generous burden. To place on a person who does not live in San Francisco. Because I now have 3 days to move a shit ton of weed. You know what's fun? Being a somewhat recognizable TV personality turned drug dealer. People just like, oh wow, man, things really fell apart for you. But give me an 8. I didn't know what to do. I had all this weed, and I didn't want to throw it away because that seemed rude. So I didn't want to. So I just lived in San Francisco for a month.
When you're at a dispensary, there's only one good question to ask. There's too many dumb questions. Don't you think, or do you think they're all pretty good questions?
No, there can be some dumb questions.
Tell me some dumb ones.
You offer somebody a sample of something and they ask you if it's gonna get them high?
Yeah, is this gonna get me high? At the liquor store, would you ever go with some whiskey? Will this get me drunk? Will this get me drunk? They'll go, get the fuck out of here. Of course everything will get you drunk, you moron. So that's dumb, I agree. I hate that question. I've heard that question too. There's only one good question, folks, I think. Only one necessary question about weed. Yeah, sativa or indica? Up or down? That's all we really want to know. That's all we really want to know. Up or down? A lot of people didn't even know about sativa and indica a few years ago. That's kind of new to a lot of people. They don't even know. They don't know there's two types of weed to most people: free and the stuff I gotta buy. Right? That's the only kind they think about. But yeah, you should know, how's it gonna make you, fall asleep, or is it gonna jazz me up, then make me fall asleep? Those are the two types of weed. So, how do we remember indica? What's the trick?
In the couch.
In the couch, that's the trick. I smoke a little stronger weed, indicoma. Indicoma is what I say. What about for sativa? How do you remember that one? Sativa. This is the second time I've heard that. And it doesn't make any sense. Sativa Diva. That doesn't help me. That sounds like your Twitter handle. Sativa up. Oh, thank you.
I live in LA now. It's weird. I feel like this is the longest time I've been in the city and I haven't asked for weed. I'm glad my kids will be watching this. I felt proud of that. And it's weird. It's weird how like weed is affecting my life now, because I don't like, you know, I live in a city where it's legal now and I don't know if I like it. I don't like buying my weed from a store. I like buying my weed from a drug dealer. That's what I'm good at. I've been practicing for years and now it's an obsolete skill. Thank you. I don't want to get it from a store. I'm sorry. And I know it's better, but it's like, I don't like the government having a hand in everything. It's kind of like when you're like 13, your parents are like, you could have a party, but we got to be upstairs. You know what I'm saying? I don't like it. Cause like I find myself lying at my dispensary the same way I do when I go to like a really nice bar and they give me like some really good liquor and I don't know what I'm tasting. The bartender's like, oh, taste this. This is a 28-year-old scotch. Do you taste that? That's oak on the back of your tongue. I'm like, I don't know what oak tastes like. I've lived a great life. But I still gotta be like, I taste that. I feel it's salty. I don't know what I'm drinking. And it's the same way when I go to my dispensary, I wanna get my weed and leave, but I can't, because I gotta get a fucking TED talk from my weed dispensary person. As soon as I walk in, I just wanna leave. I don't wanna be here. And as soon as I walk in, they're like, Al, good to see ya. We've got some shit in this week. I'm like, fuck. All right, now, these are sativas. Now, me and my boyfriend, we'll do this if we're gonna do like a Game of Thrones marathon. He's more into this than I am. I don't care for it, but he likes it. What I go for is more than indica. It's more of a full body high. And I'm like, I don't even know what a full body high is. And they're like, it's awesome. They're like, your head's completely clear, but your body is high. And I'm like, when the fuck would I ever need that? What, am I performing surgery on myself tonight? Here's what I need to know about my weed. My wife and kids are gonna be home from the mall in 45 minutes. Is that gonna be enough time for me to pull my shit together so I don't scar my child with some high-ass dad shit when it comes to, I'd be like, stop at the door, your daddy's been thinking. The government is trying to kill the black man via the dollar menu. It's written on White Castle's website, but it's written backwards. Open your third eye. I think your mom's a cop.
Okay. This is awesome, man. This is great. And I'll tell you, I'll be real with y'all. We got a long time up here. We need to just start to get to know each other. I celebrate diversity. I think you should hang out with people of different races, different ages. I think that's all good. But I'll be honest with y'all, I practice segregation one time in my life, and one time only. And that's that I only smoke weed with people in my own age demo. Shut up. I do. I'm in my mid-30s. I smoke with people in our mid-30s. We smoke old people shit. Joints, blunts, maybe a bowl if somebody got a promotion. We getting fancy, you know? I want to smoke with young people, but they got a lot of equipment. They got a lot of shit you got to know. They're like, I was like, hold the button down. I'm like, I don't know what's happening. I don't want to do this. Because they always trick you. It's like, you know, an 18-year-old kid be like, hey, Al, you want to smoke? And I'm like, man, I got a little time. All right, let's do it. And they're like, do you know that thing that they usually shoot t-shirts into the stands at NBA games? I'm like, I've seen that. We put weed in that now. Get on your knees. I'm like, I have kids. Not.
You guys need marijuana in your life. You need less. I love weed. Not everybody likes weed. You know, weed is harmful. I've lost a lot of girlfriends over weed. Not that they didn't like it. I just fucking lost them. You know? Was it? 93rd Street or 93rd Place? Fuck, she was nice. Alcohol is where the problems come from. If your husband came home and fucking hit you, he was drinking. He didn't come home all stoned and threw fucking cookies at your head. Who would you rather have driving? The drunk guy or the stoned guy? Stone guy has got the seatbelt on. He's going 5 miles per hour. He's like, holy shit. Holy shit. Whoa, that's a truck. Pull over. We're walking. Everybody get out. We almost died. You ever smoke weed and hang out with your grandmother? It's fun, because my grandmother's got Alzheimer's and I'm stoned, so we just tell the same story back and forth for like 5 hours. She makes all these cookies and I eat them, then she forgets, makes all these cookies and I eat them, then she forgets, that joke goes on for 6 hours. The worst thing I ever did on marijuana was church. I went to church stoned, panicked the whole time, thought I was gonna burst into flames. I got the munchies and went to communion 6 times. Took a thing of salsa with me. Hey, you got any more Jesus? You can do anything in church. Nobody's gonna kick you out. There's no bouncers. You can start a wave. You can throw a bowling ball up the aisle. You can dress up like Satan, just sit in the back row. Boo! Get a Jesus costume, walk in. What the fuck? Who are you people? Get out of my house! Give me that wine back. Guys, I'm fucking crazy. Listen, all right, fine. Let's talk about something else.
Living in LA, I'm from Virginia. I miss Virginia. I miss just the East. I miss just buying weed illegally. Like, I miss just. I miss meeting the motherfucker you don't know in the middle of the mall. Right? You scared, he scared. You don't know why he's scared, and then you chose to do this. Like, this is what you do. You can tell when they're scared too. They all do the same. Hold on. Why they hand get the show? Hold on. Wait. Hold on. He started asking, who that? Like, who, nigga? We in the food court. This nigga got samples. She got 2 kids. What are you talking about? You selling me 2 dimes, nigga. You not finna go do no fed time.
Not at all.
And then it's mid, nigga. Like, it ain't even good. This ain't even for me, it's for my grandma. So I'm trying to figure out. She smoke your shit and it'll. God damn, I'm high. It be like that. Hey, imagine the punchline was funny. You go to these dispensaries, you know that they got the nerve to ask for a tip at the dispensary? They got a tip jar at the dispensary, right? You ain't never, you don't smoke weed. She's like, oh wow, you ain't never. Big titty white woman sitting behind this glass and a security guard. You think I'm finna give you a tip? Not the nigga, I wasn't tipping the nigga with the gun and the brick on him. But you think I'm finna tip you cause your father owned a dispensary? I miss buying weed from them because you could guilt them. You could be like, hey, let me, come on, bro. That ain't, come on now. That, you can't do that with Ashley. Ashley, that ain't, she like, well, the scale says, like, bitch, I'll punch you in your areola. I don't smoke with everybody. Everybody don't know how to smoke. Nope. If you don't know how to smoke, don't come try to smoke with me. Especially if you don't not like you, you got to know how to hit it because sometimes the shit be, you know, hit kind of hard. I like seeing people choke when they. Why they try to hold it in? You can tell when they choke it real bad, they try to get rid of the blunt. You be like, I told you, nigga, that's a backwood. I told you. Mm-hmm. Yeah, nigga, that's moon rock. I used to say I can't date a chick that don't smoke weed, but then I dated a chick that smoked weed, and nigga, that's a bill. I smoke, you smoke? Nah. I want me a little shorty that'll hit the blunt. You feel me? Nah, I want me to be just, I'm good, but I love you. Go get the ring out the back, bitch. I love you. Don't you go nowhere.
I'm gonna say it. I love weed. There, I said it. I said it. Yeah, yeah, yeah. It's a little looked down upon in our culture, especially for Armenian women to smoke. Yeah, I was talking to this guy one time. He said, I don't like my girls to smoke weed. I was like, what the hell? Dude, are you serious? I could roll your blunts and tolmas at the same time. What is the problem here? I can keep you high, high. Those who get it. It's crazy. I also feel like weed gets such a bad rep. They call it the gateway drug. It's a gateway drug. I don't think weed is a gateway drug. I've been smoking for years. You know what is a gateway drug? A deadly pandemic, okay? Because just in the last several years, I tried coke, ecstasy, molly, shrooms. Dick? Yeah, yeah. That last one, you get addicted, it doesn't call you back. It's just... Man. Bless my uncle's heart when he found out I smoke weed. My uncle is such a sweet man. Such a gentle, sweet. Yes, give it up for my uncle. Let's butter him up a little, yeah. He's great. First thing, he found out I smoke weed, he goes, oh, chicas, Mary, you know, you can't lose weight if you smoke weed. What the hell? Damn. And then my mom found out when I was about 16, she caught me smoking weed. She was so pissed. She was so angry. She looked at me with such disgust. She's like, you couldn't take up cocaine, Mary? You would have at least lost some damn weight. It's like, damn. I could do no wrong if I'm skinny in this family, shit. So, the people pleaser that I am, I decided to take up coke, you know, just to... It didn't take me, but, you know.
You guys ever smoked weed out of an apple before? I like smoking out of an apple because I travel all the time and, you know, you can find an apple in any airport. So. The reason I like to smoke out of an apple is because obviously I don't roll. Yeah. If I'm rolling the joint, we are losing a lot of product. There ain't nobody getting high. Just trying to sniff it out of the carpet. And that's not how you do that drug. The reason I bring up the old apple pipe is a couple weeks ago I was on the road and I had one with me, waiting for my ride and for my hotel. And then down the street comes a pig on a horse. That's a cop, guys. Anyway, this mounted officer, is that better, team? Anyways, he comes clippity-clopping by, and I'm all high and paranoid, like, oh shit, what if the horse smells apple? They just keep getting closer. I'm like, this is about to fucking happen. He clippity-clops right on up to me. He recognized me. He's like, hey, I saw you on TV. I was like, sweet, can I feed your horse an apple? He let me do it. Have a fun day, officer. Would I love to see that later in the afternoon? A horse is fancy dancing. Something got into Becky. Never seen her drink so much water. Just another scenario. And then I had this happen to me. I was coming out of the San Diego airport, and I bumped into a large, muscly black cop with a German Shepherd, and he recognized me. And I thought I was playing it cool. I don't know how he saw it, but after about 2 minutes, he looks at me and goes, don't worry, Josh. It's a bomb-sniffing dog. All right. What's your puppy's name? Come here, boy. It's a little puppy. Not so scary now, are you, Doc?
The biggest change in my life, it's the hardest thing I've ever done, is over a year ago, I quit smoking pot. Thank you. If you didn't booby, I would have been so fucking disappointed. I would be like, can we get another audience in here? I boo myself every fucking morning. Every morning that doesn't begin with a wake and bake, it's like fucking boo. What am I doing? Boo. Remembering things, boo. Human contact, also boo. It sucks, it's been hard, I'll get into that more. The other third change that I've made is as, if you know me, and you'll see in the rest of this set, I talk about masturbating a lot. Because you write what you know. And I know it like the back of my, But I'm doing it a lot less as I get older, because I'm fucking old and tired all the time. So a lot of nights end with me with half a heart on going, man, I don't know what to tell you, dude. You're gonna have to work this out on your own, my friend. Daddy's tired. I'll just rub you against a wall or something. See if we can bring it home that way. You don't mind if I close my eyes a little, do you? So now, Pot and my wiener are like Buzz and Woody from Toy Story 3. They're like, what happened? He used to play with us all the time. What'd we do? This is fucked. And we just sit in a box with Mr. Potato Head. Maybe he's going off to college, Woody. If I was going to college, I would need Buzzin' Woody. But I'm not, so I don't. So I talk about one of the last times I got high was up in Portland, and I used to end my shows by getting high with strangers. And I wrote a joke, like, so I could get strangers to bring me weed, because I would travel with weed, but I got paranoid about traveling with the weed from smoking the weed. So what I would do is put my weed, like, to go through TSA, I'd put it in my underwear, and then I'm smoking ass weed all weekend, and that's no good. People don't want to share it, though, so you keep it to yourself. So what I would do is I would just talk to people before the show, and I'd do a joke so I could get people to bring me weed. And so the shows would all end with me having sessions in parking lots with total strangers just smoking whatever they brought me. Super safe, right? So this is true. There's about 20 of us outside of this comedy club in Portland. We're out downtown, and we're out. It's dimly lit by a dumpster, and we're passing around all this weed, and we've got like a couple different pipes going and a couple different joints going. And the super stoner that's kind of running the thing, he brought a backpack with a vaporizer and a bunch of different type of medical marijuanas to partake from. And so he's passing them around, and he's a super stoner. He gave himself the super stoner nickname. He calls himself Ganja John. And it's like, you don't need a stoner nickname. We can smell you. And we're passing around all this shit, and about 20 minutes later, everybody else has left, except for me and Ganja John, because I'm no rookie at that point. And I'm hanging in there. But as the kids say, I'm high as fuck. That is when Ganja John pulls out his eye. Yeah. That is how he let me know he had a fake eye. He just yanked it the fuck out. Just fucking bloop. And as I said, I'm high out of my goddamn mind on three types of medical and all this other shit. And all I see is a black hole in his face. And I think fucking demons are gonna fly out of there just fucking bruh. I'm like, what is happening? And he goes, I like to fuck with people. And I'm like, clearly. You should put that on a shirt. And then my main thing was, look, if you have a fake eye, and if you think it's like a nice conversation piece, it's like a good way to get something started, get move on to a new topic or whatever, use words. Go, hey, guess what? I have a fake eye. So I can say proper response. That's fucked up. Don't play with darts, I guess. I don't know. Then give me the option. Go, would you like to see said fake eye? So I can either go, yeah, I guess, or fuck no, keep that shit in your face. Instead, no option given by Ganja John. Just fucking bloop. And I'm like, bruh. And he goes, you know, he says to me, I like to fuck with people. And then he shows me just how he likes to fuck with people. What he does next is he pulls out his iPhone. And again, he only has one of those too. He pulls out his iPhone, and on the iPhone is a photographic evidence of how he screws with people. What he will do is shove little things in his gross eye hole and then head out for the evening with the eye patch over it, hiding gross things. Yes, I saw it. Horrible. He will put Monopoly figures in there. Yes. Like the thimble or the little old-timey car or the shoe. Just boink, and then head out into the evening to horrify humans. The worst thing he does, again, I saw it, is he will shove a nice green bud in there. A nice little bud of weed, green bud with little red hairs, and I fucking miss it. He'll shove that in there, put the eye patch on, head out to a kegger or whatever, and be hanging around with people and go, oh, I'm out of weed. And they'll go, oh, that sucks, me too. And he'll go, oh, wait, I know where I have some more. Fucking blah. And they'll never smoke pot again. I was like, if you really want to fuck with people, you should put like a little lit candle in there. Go, look, I'm a pothead lantern. People fucking run from you, kicking and punching you.
So the first decision that I made to be a good guy is I decided to quit smoking marijuana. Illegally. And I got my pot card. Well, I live in California right now where, you know, you still have to lie to doctors. And the thing about it is they say it's so easy. You go into the doctor and you say, my back hurts or I've got anxiety, and they just want you to smoke weed. And so I went into a doctor and said, I've got anxiety that someday my back might hurt. And he said, dude, that's a serious issue. A lot of people your age are dealing with that right now. Let's cut that off before it starts. And he gave me a weed card. Because I think scumbags go to drug dealers, but good guys lie to doctors. And so there I am. I've got my weed card. The feeling of having your weed card, I've just ran out into the streets of LA like, where are we? Where are we going? And there's weed stores everywhere, and I picked one, and I hoped it was the right one, and I go in, and it was, because there was weed there. And if you've never been into a weed store, the best way to describe it is that it's like every store you've ever been in, but all weed, right? And so they've got everything. They've got like weed water, weed sodas, trail mix, lip balm, lotions, and they even just have this little area in the corner where they just have weed. Like where our forefathers used to smoke. And I'm an old-fashioned guy. I like to smoke weed. I like to smoke a weed. It is a saying that I have coined. So I bought some weed to smoke, and I said, thank you so much. And I turned to walk out, and it didn't feel real. I just bought drugs, and I was able to walk outside. And I turned to walk out, and with drugs in one hand and a hand on a doorknob to freedom, from over my shoulder, I hear, oh, Mr. Thune, one more thing. And that's the moment that you realize it's been a 6-year sting operation focused on me. And there's like 8 cops out in the van like, I didn't think you'd fucking do it. We're going home. Jason, you're gonna meet your daughter. And I turn around just like, just where's the handcuffs? Just break them out. And she doesn't have handcuffs. She's actually holding a weed brownie. And she says, Mr. Thune, I know it's your first time here and it's a cutthroat business out there. We're glad you chose us, and we hope you keep coming back. And to show our gratitude, here's a free weed brownie. And she handed me a weed brownie that was about the size of a VHS tape. And I know this is streaming, and there's younger audiences. It's like 4 Apple TVs. Same amount of content. And I'm holding the weed brownie and I'm looking at it, and I'm gonna be honest, I don't like to eat weed brownies because I don't like to feel like I'm dying all the time. But we all learn in elementary school, you never say no to drugs. You accept the drug, you either learn to like it or you give it to your best friend on his wedding day. And so I accepted the weed brownie and I said, thank you so much, thank you. Someday. And I turned to walk out. And as I turned to walk out and I had my hand on the door again, she said, oh, wait, Mr. Thune, I almost forgot one more thing. And that's the moment you realize that they just planted more drugs on me. The guys in the van are like, I didn't think you'd do that. Offer him coke. See what he says. Tell him there's hookers in the back. And I turn around just like, just call my wife, tell her it's over. Just take me away. And she says, what I almost forgot to tell you is make sure and only eat an eighth of it. And I was like, an eighth of it? And she was like, I mean, yeah, basically what you want to do, I mean, okay, what you want to do is you want to, first off, you just want to break it up into halves. And then what you're going to want to do is, you want to break both those up into halves. And then at that point, and I was like, oh, no, I know fractions. Oh, I am so sorry I didn't stop you. I didn't know you were defining fractions. I was just curious as to how you almost forgot to tell me that I might die. But thank you so much. Thank you.
Smoke a lot of weed. Yes. Yeah, I love weed. Like, I smoked so much weed, one time I caught myself passing weed to myself. I was like, hit this, Dave. And I pass it back to Dave. When I really knew how much of a weed smoker I was one time I took a break from smoking, and I was at Ralph's, and I was in the deli, and I was like, let me get an eighth of potato wedges. And I want to see you put it on the scale, too. So I know it's 3.5. And I was like, and I'll take a gram of broccoli salad too. No stems, no sticks, no seeds. Just your finest, greenest broccoli. And then she wanted to ring me up. And I was like, no. I want a hand-to-hand transaction here. Like, let's do this out in the alley, you know? Make me feel good about my purchase.
My middle kid, she's really funny, really funny. And she's clever, probably the most clever one of the bunch. Here's the irony of her being clever is she's got the brewer look. Yeah, you know the look, the one that half you've been judging that you never see me live, like, wow, he comes on stage looking like that. So, and I didn't realize how funny this look was until I saw my daughter staring at a butterfly for an hour. And she, thank God that social services weren't doing spot checks. I would have been in bad trouble. Like, oh my goodness, we got a child. I don't know what she's on the front. So this kid looks wrecked. She's wrecked. She's, and her face is all relaxed. She can't even speak. I go, what are you doing? The butterfly. The butterfly, Dad. The butterfly. And this lady pulled up and she gets out of the car. And she's concerned for my daughter. She's coming up to my door, and I'm watching. She's going, sweetheart, there's something wrong with this child, Charlie. Sweetheart, are you okay? What's going on with you today? She doesn't even acknowledge her. She's a butterfly. Did someone give you a brownie today? There's something wrong with this child. Call the police. Who is with this child? And then that's when I have to come out. Excuse me. She's with me, and we're checking out butterflies, if you want to join us. Here we go, butterfly. You laughing at my kid's face? By the time you hit the third one, I find myself lying just to not deal with it. You know, the poor kid will come like, Dad, can we go to the park? Oh, man, it's closed. I wanted to go, and I Googled it, said closed. It's a beautiful day. And then I got in the car, and it's broke down. The only thing working is the game that Dad's watching. It's so annoying. So annoying. It's aggravating. It's not fair. It's not fair. You know, but... Because you can't reason with kids. I don't reason with a kid. My daughter hits the floor and starts whining. I just step right over them. I go, let me know that works out. This is a high kidnapping area, so be careful.
This song is about spilling bong water as if it was written by Neil Young.
Please don't spill your bong water on me.
that smell won't go away. It'll stick with you till you die. Don't ask me why. Don't spill your bong water on me. Comes the time bong needs cleaning. Comes the time to scrape out the tar. Remove the resin. Replace the water. That way if it spills, it won't be so bad. Till then, don't spill bong water on me or the rug or my couch, but especially not my weed. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen.